go through it together. If you know it, of course, go ahead and sing along. All right, guys?
Have your letter out, Dr. Steve.
Thank you. amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Lord, you laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I say.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Miss Jen, here with you again to continue talking about King David and now his grandson. So before we begin, make sure you've gathered everything that we're going to need. If you haven't already printed out the class notes, that is available to you in the YouTube description part of the video. Also something to write with and your Bibles. Please have your Bibles so that we can dig into God's Word together and learn together. You can press pause at any time to take your time and find Bible verses or gather your things, whatever you need to do. So I'll be waiting. Okay, guys, so before we dig into today's lesson, let's bow our heads before the Lord. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, God, for everyone watching. Thank you for keeping them safe and their family safe. Lord, we pray that anyone who is sick, that you would put your healing hand over them. And we just pray, Lord, that you would be with us, just preparing our hearts to learn more about you and just love you for your unconditional love toward us. We love you because you loved us first, and we just thank you for that. Let us be grateful for that every day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay, guys, so we've talked about King Saul, King David, and now David's son, King Solomon. The decisions that these kings made affected not only them, but also their families and the people that they ruled. So what are some things that we've learned about King Solomon from the Bible? So you may have said a couple of things that we talked about last week. He was the wisest man to ever live. He built the temple and he wrote the book of Proverbs. So God blessed Solomon with wisdom to rule the people of Israel well. He built the temple, a permanent house of worship for God, and he wrote sayings called Proverbs to teach his sons and the people. So seeking for wisdom is like searching for hidden treasure. It takes time and effort, but the benefits include avoiding sins that can hurt us and those that we love around us. So what are some of the practical things we can learn from Proverbs? What topics are covered in Proverbs? You can pause the video and tell your parents if you remember what we talked about last week. So Proverbs teaches about being a good friend, listening to our parents, watching what we say, working hard, being humble, and so much more. Solomon also wrote two other books of the Bible. Do you know which ones those are? If you look in the table of contents, you could probably find a very strong clue in there. You can pause the video and at least find one of them. If you said Ecclesiastes, that is correct. And the Song of Solomon. So the Song of Solomon is a true life dramatic love song. It shows the love God intended between a husband and a wife in marriage. Ecclesiastes gives Solomon's experience for searching for meaning in pleasure, wisdom, folly, and work throughout his life. In the end, he concluded that man should enjoy life but not sin, because God will judge. So a little more than 120 years before King Solomon's reign, the people had demanded a man for a king. This was during the time of Samuel the judge, and even though God was their king, God gave them what they asked for. But he knew that any king that was a mere man would have a sinful heart. He warned the people that the kings must obey him. We're going to talk about that today, and we're going to fill in the class notes as we go through the lesson. So let's go to the book of Deuteronomy so we can see what God said to the people about their king. So let's go to Deuteronomy, big number 17, and we're going to look for the little 15 through 17. So you can press pause and find that in your Bible so you can read along with me, because then we answer questions to understand it, right? So Deuteronomy 17, 15 through 17. You shall surely set a king over you whom the Lord your God chooses, one from among your brothers or brethren. You shall set as a king over you. You may not set a foreigner over you who is not your brother, but he shall not multiply horses for himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt to multiply horses, for the Lord has said to you, you shall not return that way again. Neither shall he multiply wives for himself, lest his heart turn away, nor shall he greatly multiply silver and gold for himself. Okay, so let's break that down and understand it with questions, okay? So in verse 15, what did God tell the Israelites about choosing a king? Look at verse 15. You shall surely set a king over you whom the Lord your God chooses. Someone from within them, within their people. So he would choose their king. Their king must be an Israelite and not someone from the outside, not a foreigner. So there were certain things God made very clear that he did not want the kings to acquire or collect for themselves. What did God say that kings must not acquire in verses 16 and 17? Take a look. So yeah, he said many horses and wives, excessive silver and gold. So those are the things that he does not want them to have. So God explained why he gave the command not to take many wives in verse 17, What could happen if they do that? Look at verse 17. Lest his heart turn away. Yours might be a little different, your version of the Bible, but it could turn the king's heart away from God. What do you think that this means? How could that happen? So God knew that kings often took wives from other nations in order to keep peace or make alliances with those other countries. But of course, God's design for marriage has always been one man and one woman for life. So taking many wives was disobedience to God's plan. Also, the wives from other countries would bring their false gods with them. It would be very easy for the king to start worshiping his wives' false gods. This would break the first commandment from God to have no other gods before him. God had higher standards in mind for the kings of Israel. He wanted them to worship only him, and he wanted them to have only one wife. This means that the king should not collect lots of riches, gold and silver, for their own selfish pleasure. God knew that kings could get carried away with getting rich, that their wealth could become an idol, meaning that they would love their riches more than they loved God. God was warning them not to do that. So to review, what are the things that kings were commanded not to acquire? They were commanded not to acquire horses, wives, silver, and gold. Good job, guys. So let's start the class notes. What word from the word bank completes number one? That would be wealth. So before any kings were put in place, God gave instructions for the kings to obey him and learn his commandments. Remember, God wanted to be their king. God knew that kings would be tempted to collect horses, marry women, many women, to seek gold and silver. So God wanted the kings to depend on him for their success rather than their wealth. So how would you complete number two on your class notes? So that would be depend. So this was what God told the kings he wanted them to do. Did Solomon do these things? His kingdom started off well. He built the temple. He asked God for wisdom and he ruled the people well. But Solomon was a man and all men are sinners. Solomon was no exception. So let's turn to 1 Kings. I'm going to look for it here because it's a little more simple than my Bible. Let's look for 1 Kings 11, big 11, 1 through 4. So 1 Kings 11, 1 through 4. Follow along as I read. But King Solomon loved many foreign women as well as the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonites, and Hittites, from the nations of whom the Lord had said to the children of Israel, you shall not intermarry with them, nor they with you. Surely they will turn away your hearts after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it was so when Solomon was old that his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not loyal to the Lord his God, and as was the heart of his father David. Oh man. So question, did Solomon obey God? No, right? How many women did King Solomon love? He loved many foreign women. Where did these women come from? So in 1 Kings 11:2, it says, from the nations that God said not to have wives from. The women were from foreign countries. These were the very foreign women that God told Solomon not to marry. Yet Solomon disobeyed God and did what he wanted to do. So how many wives did Solomon have? In 1 Kings 11:3, we read 700 wives. So the wives of Solomon did not believe in the true God. What happened to Solomon because of his foreign wives? In 1 Kings 11:4, we read that his heart turned away after other gods. He was not true to the Lord. Solomon had disobeyed God's commands. Remember, God gave instructions that kings must not marry many wives, and now Solomon's heart was changed by the woman he married. He was not faithful or loyal to the Lord. He was worshiping the same false gods his wives worshiped. So what does God think about anyone who disobeys him? You can pause and talk to the person next to you. Share with the person next to you. So we know that God does not like disobedience. He demands obedience and trust, which attribute means that God must punish sin. That attribute of God is called just, being just. God was angry with Solomon for breaking his commandments. Solomon had been given many blessings from God, wisdom and wealth, and yet he chose to follow his wives in worshiping false gods. So let's read what God said to Solomon in 1 Kings 11:11-13. So therefore the Lord said to Solomon, because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days for the sake of your father David. I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away the whole kingdom. I will give one tribe to your son, and for the sake of my servant David, and for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen. Okay. So what was the Lord going to do to Solomon because of his disobedience? What was going to happen to the kingdom? He was going to tear the kingdom away from him and give it to his servant. When did God say that he would do this? He said, not in the days of Solomon, but in the reign of his son. So even in his punishment of Solomon, God showed mercy by saying that he would delay the judgment. Why did God say he would tear the kingdom away from away during Solomon's days? Why would he not tear the kingdom away during Solomon's days? He said that for the sake of who? The sake of David, Solomon's father. So in verse 13, God promised to still give something to Solomon's son. What was it? One tribe. So God said that the kingdom would go to one of Solomon's servants, but for David's sake, he would give one tribe for his son to rule over. So God was keeping his promise to David. So there's an important principle here about disobedience and obedience. Did Solomon's sin affect only him? No, right? Who else would it affect? It affected his son and his kingdom, his people. So Solomon's son would now bear the consequences of his father's sin. But the reverse is true with David. Because of David's obedience and faithfulness, God showed mercy to Solomon. We must remember that our sin can hurt others, but our obedience to God can bring blessings to us and those around us. So look at number 3 on your class notes. What sin did Solomon commit? It was the sin of disobedience, right? So Solomon disobeyed God in many ways. He knew better. He had started out so well, building the temple, asking for wisdom, and worshiping God. It's so sad to see that the wisest man made such foolish decisions. So how would God punish Solomon for his disobedience? For number 4. So you're going to write kingdom in the first line and servant in the second. So what next? Well, because God is holy and just, and because Solomon sinned, God punished him by tearing the kingdom away. But we'll see how God worked that out next. So King Solomon reigned over all Israel for 40 years before he died. Remember, God had said that the kingdom would go to Solomon's servant. But first, Solomon's son, Rehoboam, did take over the kingdom. When Rehoboam took the throne, the people were hopeful that this new king would treat them better than Solomon had treated them. Solomon had been hard on the people, forcing them to work for him. They were hoping that his son Rehoboam would not be like Solomon was. The people sent Solomon's servant Jeroboam to talk to the king. So you're probably piecing together in your head what's going to happen based on what God already said would happen, right? So Jeroboam's his servant. Rehoboam is Solomon's son. So let's see what happens. So Jeroboam went to King Rehoboam, Solomon's son, to ask if he would be kinder to the people than his father Solomon had been. So let's read King Rehoboam's response to Jeroboam and the people. So I will read 1 Kings 12, 13 through 15. The king answered the people roughly and rejected the advice which the elders had given him. And he spoke to them according to the advice of the young men, saying, "My father made your yoke heavy, but I will add to your yoke. My father chastised you with whips, but I will chastise you with scourges or scorpions." So this king did not listen to the people, for the turn of events was from the Lord, that he might fulfill his word, which the Lord had spoken by Ahijah the Shilonite and Jeroboam the son of Nebat. Okay, guys. So whose counsel did Rehoboam take when he gave his answer? Did he listen to the old men or to the young men? So Rehoboam listened to the young men. He chose to ignore the wise counsel of the old men who advised his father. They had told him to speak kindly to the people. Instead, Rehoboam listened to the young men, the friends that he grew up with. So what was Rehoboam saying when he said he'd add to their yoke and discipline them with scorpions? Was he going to be nicer to the people? What do you think? Rehoboam showed an unkind heart toward the people. He said he'd make them work harder and punish them worse than his father had. He hadn't listened to the people or showed compassion. So who was in charge of all of these events? Who was in control? The Lord, right? Look at number 5 on your class notes. What was the name of Solomon's servant and the spokesperson for the people? That was, like we said before, Jeroboam. And what was the name of Solomon's son for number 6? Rehoboam, right? So, and for number 7, we read that who was in charge, controlling everything that was happening? Who was in control? God. So God was in control. Remember, he had told Solomon that one day the kingdom would be torn from his hands and his servant would rule. Now King Rehoboam refused to do what the people asked, and the people got upset. So let's jump down to 1 Kings 20 through 21. So now it came to pass, when all Israel heard... Sorry guys, let me just check that this is the right one. 20 through 21. So now it came to pass, when all Israel had heard that Jeroboam had come back, they sent for him and called him to the congregation and made him king over all Israel. There was none who followed the house of David, but the tribe of Judah only. And when Rehoboam came to Jerusalem, he assembled all the house of Judah with the tribe of Benjamin, 180,000 chosen men who were warriors to fight against the house of Israel, that he might restore the kingdom to Rehoboam, the son of Solomon. But the word of God came to Shemaiah the man of God, saying, "Speak to Rehoboam, the son of Solomon, king of Judah, to all the house of Judah and Benjamin, and to the rest of the people, saying, Thus says the Lord, you shall not go up nor fight against your brethren, the children of Israel. Let every man return to his house, for this thing is from me." Therefore, they obeyed the word of the Lord and turned back according to the word of the Lord. So what did the people do when the servant of Jeroboam, when Jeroboam came back, they made Jeroboam king over Israel. Wow. What about Solomon's son, King Rehoboam? What tribe followed him as their king? The tribe of Judah. Only one tribe, Judah, stayed loyal to the house of David and kept Rehoboam as their king. It's exactly what God had said to Solomon. For the sake of David, God would let Solomon's son remain king over one tribe, but the other 10 tribes followed Jeroboam. The people from the tribes of Benjamin and Levi were spread out in the land, so some served King Rehoboam and some served King Jeroboam. So where did King Rehoboam end up? In which city? He ended up in the city of Jerusalem. So what was King Rehoboam doing in Jerusalem? King Rehoboam was trying to gather the men to fight against Israel so he could get his kingdom back from Jeroboam. He was planning to take the rest of the kingdom back from the new King Jeroboam, but would that work? Let's go to 1 Kings 12:24. Thus says the Lord, you shall not go up nor fight against your brethren, the children of Israel. Let every man return to his house, for this thing is from me. Therefore, they obeyed the word of the Lord and turned back according to the word of the Lord. So was Rehoboam's attempt to take back Israel successful? Nope. Who stopped him? The Lord, right? The Lord stopped him. The Lord said he was in control and that all the people should return to their homes. The men of Judah with Rehoboam were not to fight against the other tribes and Jeroboam, and the people obeyed the word of the Lord. So which attribute of God does this verse remind you of? This attribute tells us that God is in control of everything. What does that mean? He is sovereign, right? God was certainly showing his sovereign control over this entire situation. Just like God had announced, the kingdom was torn from Solomon. Solomon's servant would take the throne. Jeroboam was the new king of the northern kingdom. God allowed Solomon's son Rehoboam to rule over a small section of the kingdom Judah in the south. And the Bible told us all of these events would happen, that they were in the hands of the Lord. God's plan was being completed. So God divided the kingdom of Israel into two nations. So write that in the blank for number 8 on your class notes. The number 2. What was the answer for number 9 on the class notes? On your class notes, the answer was Israel. let's read number 10. The southern kingdom of Rehoboam was called, the southern part was called Judah. So King Solomon started off well as a king when he asked God for wisdom, but he disobeyed God's commands for kings. He collected horses, gold, silver. He took many foreign wives. Solomon did not stay true to God. Sadly, he turned to idolatry. This is why God had to punish his sin. He told Solomon that the kingdom would be taken away from his son, and that's exactly what happened. The kingdom was divided between King Rehoboam and Solomon's son in the south and King Jeroboam, Solomon's servant, in the north. The judgment of the Lord had come to pass. So God demands our obedience, and he will not tolerate his people worshiping anything other than him. He calls us to love him with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Although we don't worship carved idols or have 700 wives or husbands today, we turn away from God in other ways. What do we read? What do we watch on TV? What do we do when no one is looking? How do we treat parents, brothers and sisters, teachers and friends? Are we living so that others see that we love God above everything else? And we want to obey him and honor him with every part of our lives. It is worth thinking about and praying about. Then if God shows us an area of sin, we should be quick to ask for forgiveness, turn from it, and return to being obedient. Okay, so let's just close in prayer. Thank you, Lord, for this lesson. Thank you, Lord, for showing us your mercy, Lord, and your how you are just to punish sin, Lord. We just pray, Lord, that you would help us all of our days to help to be obedient to you. And when we fall and when we're not, that we would turn quickly to you, Lord, and that you would just put us on your path of righteousness for your name's sake, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, guys, have a great week. See you soon.